Welcome to the Peep Show Podcast.
Your glance at sex and social justice.
With Jesse and PJ Sage. Welcome back to another episode of the Peep Show Podcast. We have a great show for you today. Mistress Eva will talk to us about working as an Asian dominatrix. But first, Melissa Mariposa joins us for our new segment to talk about a web hosting platform she established for sex workers trying to survive in a post-FOSTA-SESTA world. Before we get started, we want to remind you that we have a Patreon and we would love your support. You can visit us at patreon.com/peepshowpodcast. We are here today with Melissa Mariposa, who is a longtime industry veteran behind Tristworthy Enterprises. She is also a Twitter OG with an account that turned 10 in January. So thanks so much for joining us.
My account is older than most people's children.
That's true. I've only been on Twitter for a year. I just learned how to use Twitter recently.
I think my oldest Twitter account is 2007, but that's not this one.
Oh, wow. You have been on it for a long time. PJ's actually been on Twitter a long time,
too. Yeah, I think I have a vanilla account from 2008, but it's probably not that old, so.
I looked at it and I was like, this is going to be something. Like, this is stupid, but this is going to be something.
I really like it. I really like Twitter, especially the community building and the sex work community. I think it's really great.
I think of all of our choices, it's the best one for social media, but I still think as a whole, the industry was a little better before social media. Some guys may disagree because now they get a chance to get to know the women for free.
What do you think? What do you think the differences are?
In this part of sex work, like in escorting prostitution, before it would be the guy would read your ad, maybe send a couple emails or back in the day call you, and that was the extent of your content. Now he can like DM you.
Yeah.
Send you gift cards and wish list items. And that stuff's great. Don't get me wrong. But some people take a little liberty with the DMs.
Yeah, I noticed that too, even in my area of it, which is phone sex and clip making, that a lot of people will send me all kinds of DMs and want a lot of attention. And I think I have a platform for this where I get paid to do this. So why don't you move over there? But it's you have to say that in kind of a delicate way.
Well, you know what? We feel like entitled to porn for free.
Right.
Because people have been stealing it for so long that we feel entitled to porn for free because those aren't people. That's right. Porn.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody deserves porn. And it just bleeds over into every aspect of the sex industry.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because
that's
people
right.
feel entitled to sex is what it comes down to.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's right.
And then as a result, entitled to sex workers' time and the fruits of their labor.
Right. Because we're not even real women. We're just sex workers.
I don't like that part of it. I don't like the constant DMs of people asking my advice on their relationships, or they'll come to me with their fantasies and their like erections. And I don't love that. But I like the community building with the other women. That's what I like.
Oh, I absolutely agree.
Yeah, we were super interested to talk to you because I saw this week there was a Nation article that talked about the Red Umbrella hosting service that you just started. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about that.
Right. So I started Red Umbrella back in March when SESTA passed. It went 97-2. And I looked and I went, we're not going to have websites very long, are we? Because when things happen, like people get scared, even if there's no reason to get scared, like there's no reason to be scared. There really hasn't been some giant crackdown on us since the stuff passed.
Right.
And the back page thing was going to happen regardless of if SESTA passed. None of the charges are related to SESTA. None.
Yeah.
And so we can't sit here and be like, oh, well, Backpage was a victim to SESTA. No, that was just convenient timing for them.
Well, it inspired SESTA and FOSTA, though, even if it wasn't used to prosecute them.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Oh, sure. But what I mean is in terms of big crackdowns, we haven't had like a major site get busted because of SESTA.
Right.
Directly.
Right.
And the law used against the site. It hasn't happened.
Right. For the most part, the things that have happened, it's sites shutting down out of fear more than actual use of the law or the law
exactly
being tested.
And that's
court.
What they want. Well, that's what they wanted, right? They wanted us to self-regulate through fear.
Yeah. I mean, there's been a lot of social media accounts, I think, that have been shut down. That's certainly been happening.
That's always been happening. I've been on Twitter about 10 years now. That's been happening. The thing is like Twitter has very few rules for us, but they do have some. Don't put your nipples in your avatar. Don't put nudity on your cover photo. A lot of people do that. I see it every day. People do it. and you don't get caught for a year or two, great. And then you get banned and you're like, well, what did I get banned for? Well, maybe it's because your titties were hanging out in your profile picture. And the thing with shadow banning is that we're not being targeted. Shadow banning targets anyone who exhibits bot-like behavior, which unfortunately for our industry is us, because we retweet a lot. And we post a lot of links. And those are two of the big no-nos for shadow banning, is a lot of links and a lot of retweets. And that's exactly what sex workers do.
Yeah, and a lot of the auto-generated tweets when you make sales or when you go on and offline. Right. Those things trigger the shadow banning.
Right. And so it's not like Twitter was like, oh, how do we best hurt sex workers? Ha ha, visibility issues. That wasn't, like, we're caught up in another algorithm and it just kind of sucks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It just happens to have like a disproportionately negative impact on sex workers based on how they do their job on the internet.
Right, because this is our livelihood, not like a game.
Right, mm-hmm. Yeah. So you think that there isn't really a problem with social media in the same way that there is with websites?
Not at all. First of all, Twitter is really smart about it. They're not just a U.S. company. They're also in Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
So technically, if you access them with a VPN and your location isn't listed as the U.S., how are they ever going to know that you're American? They're going to have to apply the international law to you and to your account.
Yeah, which FOSTA and SESTA doesn't cover.
Right. Social media isn't our concern.
Yeah, but what the websites are, though.
Websites are, because as soon as this happened, a lot of the free sites just were like, nope, this isn't worth it, which makes sense because all of their money, if you've looked at free websites, a lot of them put banner ads on the girls' websites that say like, fuck in your city tonight. It's like some porn site. It's not, you know, like a real sex site.
Right.
Those sites are the ones that funded all of those free websites. As soon as SESTA hit, those websites were like, nope, we're done. So when your biggest advertiser pulls, what do? Except shut down.
Right, right.
Yeah. These people who have these free websites aren't going to pay for them. The reason they use your service is because it's free. Most of these weren't great services. They just were free and they existed and they were for sex workers. And there's a very limited number of tools that we have, which is part of why I've started to make tools. We have very few tools. When it comes to ad websites, honestly, what are there, like four? You know, it's not a plentiful venue for us.
Yeah,
and it
right.
wasn't before FOSTA. And it's not now, especially with more things shutting down. Some sites have been really hit or miss about it. Like Squarespace has kicked off a few girls, but then other girls say they've spoken to them and Squarespace says it's fine. Same deal with Wix. People are like, Wix shut down my site, but then other people are like, Wix assured me they're in Israel and it's fine.
Wow.
I think it really depends on who you get when you make your service call.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's
really
scary to me.
Yeah.
I don't want my livelihood to rest on who gets my service call.
Right. Right. It's very arbitrary.
Tell us a little bit about how you set up your site.
So I've been into web design and development since the AOL days, is how I like to describe it. Like, since we were getting AOL discs in the mail, I had a big, thick book that was how to make a website. And it was all HTML, and I'd write it out on notebook paper at school and come home and put it in the computer when I got home and see if it worked. And so I've always built my own website by hand. I got lazy for a couple years and did WordPress, but I've always built my own website and I've always had a private server, but I had a private server in the US because it wasn't really a huge concern.
Mm-hmm.
A couple years ago, I moved to the Netherlands. Felt like something like this was too easy. You know what I mean? Like this couldn't always stay like this. This is too easy.
Yeah.
And so I moved to the Netherlands. I moved everything I had to the Netherlands, I'd say in late 2015.
Okay.
And to your website?
Yeah. In terms of my website. And so when FOSTA happened, I was already, like, I was good to go, right? I was on a VPS. I could have just sat on my VPS in the Netherlands and been fine. But I looked at it and I said, wow, like, people who don't know how to do this are going to be kind of screwed. Like, if you don't know how to set up your own server, whether it's leasing a full dedicated server or a VPS, what are you going to do, right?
Yeah.
The other problem is you can buy cheap hosting. Like, you can go to Orange website. I highly recommend them and like them. If you need really cheap hosting, they got you. The issue is if you need comprehensive tech support, if you don't understand how to migrate your website, if you don't know how FTP works, they can't help you with any of that.
Okay.
So what I offer is the full package. You want to move your Squarespace site to WordPress, I'm here to help you. That's part of the money you pay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you're actually helping other sex workers set up their sites on your hosting service.
Right. So I'll set up the hosting and I'll help you migrate the site. If your site's very complicated, like some sites make it really hard to export your site. Wix is a really good example. Wix doesn't want you to export your site. They want you to stay with them forever.
Yeah.
So I can help recreate a Wix site, but it's usually like an extra $100 because of it, the amount of time it takes, because I have to rebuild the entire site.
Because you're basically, you're having to recreate it, how it looks, but you're creating all new code for it.
Right. And it's not that it's difficult, it's just time consuming.
Right.
And so I try to keep that reasonable. I firmly believe that you can get into a website with a year of hosting from the ground up for $500 or less.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I fully believe that should be a possibility. And that's what I try to offer. Now, of course, I can do a full custom site with all the bells and whistles. If you look at my website, it's full custom. I can make you something like that. But, you know, that's a four-digit number.
Yeah, right.
My website's an application.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So if I'm sitting there, like, you know, setting up things that involve framework versus content management, it's a different price point. But I can get you in a WordPress site with a year of hosting if you've never had a website, for under $500.
Yeah. Have you had a lot of sex workers who have come to you to either build them websites or migrate their sites over to Red Umbrella Hosting?
I would say that 75% of my clientele is migrations. And then I would say that 15% build their own sites. And then the other 10% are like, please help me build this. And sometimes I'll help you. And then there's times where I'll do it for you. Like I offer both, right? Because if you know what to do generally, but maybe you don't know how to install your theme or set up your form, you don't need the whole thing. You just need one thing done.
Right.
So it's completely customizable. That's why I don't have packages for like design and assistance. It's like whatever you need.
Right.
And then there's an amount for my time based on the job we're doing.
Have you had any fear about setting this up post-FOSTA-SESTA, or is the fact that it's offshore hosted make you feel comfortable doing it?
Let them come get me. Let them come. Let them knock down my door. Let them find me. I have no client records. I do not take any personal information. They're going to get a bunch of usernames and some websites that are publicly available on the internet. If that's how the government wants to spend their money, by all means, piss it down the toilet.
Because
that's what it feels like. Honestly, what are they? So think about it this way. I chose Iceland because they don't have an MLAT with the United States, which is the assistance treaty.
Okay.
So to even try to get anything from the server, they have to go through like an arduous subpoena process with a company that doesn't openly cooperate with them.
Yeah.
That doesn't seem like a lot of return on what they're doing. I usually like to say that I feel like in this industry that all law enforcement goes for what I consider, the term that was said to me was low-hanging fruit, the people who don't take any precautions. Backpage was a great example. They ran their servers openly in Arizona. Very easy for the government to just walk in.
Yeah.
I'm making them jump through at least six hoops to even get anything. Why? Why would they want to? It's just a web hosting company.
Right.
The interesting thing is there's more sex slavery on Twitter than there is any other website, and Twitter hasn't changed. They like really lightly changed some of their policies to kind of flesh out their nudity policy and stuff a little more. But if Twitter isn't running scared, I don't necessarily see a reason for the rest of us to be running scared. I realize Twitter has like billions of dollars and lawyers to hide behind, but at the same time, wouldn't they be the perfect place to make an example? There's so many sex workers and so much porn on Twitter.
Yeah.
The idea that there's not tons of sex slavery, come on.
Mm-hmm.
You can find beheadings on Twitter.
Mm.
Like, so, you can find anything on Twitter. Twitter is the darkest part of the surface web.
Mm.
That's what I'll say. Twitter's the darkest part of the surface web. You can find some really gnarly stuff on Twitter. If the government isn't looking at Twitter and saying, well, this is where all the trafficked women are, we need to make an example out of this, I don't know that they're going to come after like small-time hosting companies and small-time ad websites.
I mean, there's very little evidence that any sex trafficking has been limited by raids that are taking place across the country under the auspices of sex trafficking.
Well, if anything, isn't it worse now? Because without Backpage, how do we find traffickers?
Mm-hmm.
How do we find people who are enslaving people if there's not ad websites for police to do stings on?
Right.
Right. No,
like,
I'm not
sitting here saying, oh yeah, I love sex stings and that's great that law enforcement does stings, but where the hell are they supposed to find these people?
Oh, and I think agents at the FBI have suggested as much that their ability to target trafficking has been hindered since the passage of FOSTA-SESTA because there just isn't the openness, and that all sex work has gone further underground. But the fact that it's gone further underground has meant that it's opened up more opportunities for sex traffickers to hide, essentially, or has given them more tools to hide. But that actually raises an interesting point. Is that a concern of yours?
Oh, absolutely. So I work at a brothel. And I try to keep my finger on the pulse of what's going on in all the brothels. And not only are applications and hires up everywhere, so are people recruiting for their pimps. Yeah, you would think in a place where you're already giving away 50% of your money, you wouldn't find women that are pimped, but I'm going to spoil it for you. It's pretty common. And I think that since this has happened, more women who are pimped have turned to legal prostitution to protect them from being arrested. The problem with that is that while legal prostitution is technically legal in the state of Nevada, if you read FOSTA, you're only provided with an affirmative defense.
Meaning?
Like, you can still be arrested.
Mm.
Even though it's federally illegal. So you can be, let's say I advertise my services in Nevada on my website, and they come to me and they arrest me. I can provide the affirmative defense. Well, this is legal in my state, just like marijuana, right? You can argue, well, I can have marijuana because I live in Colorado or Washington.
Right.
But you could still be arrested on a federal level. So that's the same situation for this, is that if they wanted to, this is another reason I don't think people should necessarily be as scared as they are. If they wanted to, tomorrow they could kick down the door of all the legal brothels in Nevada and raid them and make an example and try to find these victims.
Yeah.
Okay, so why haven't they done that? It's been since March. Knock on wood, right?
Right.
They want to make a lot of splashing and they don't want to actually do anything. They don't want to do anything except make noise.
Yeah, that's all really interesting, I think.
How about in terms of hosting? Are you concerned about traffickers or the, you know, these kinds of people who are engaged in the darker side of sex work?
I try to be careful about that. Like, I definitely have men that email me and they're like, hi, I have a friend that wants hosting. I'm like, you're gonna have to CC your friend on this email and they're gonna have to start talking. Like,
there's
no way I'm gonna set up a website for a woman where the only contact I have is the man. I totally understand some people have developers. Some people totally do have their boyfriends legitimately help them with their job. Some people have male assistants, you know, some people, and some people work for agencies. That's not trafficking, and that's not, you know, how I feel about that. It doesn't matter. They're not victims, and so I'm happy to help them set up a site through whoever they want to set up a site through.
Right.
I try to really monitor who's signing up, in the sense that, first of all, signups aren't automated. We have to have a discussion before there's any money even changing hands.
Right.
I'm not just, this is not like you fill in a form and I automatically, like, the account set up. No, there's just no, there's a barrier for entry in that sense. I won't do accounts for any brothels because where have they been for us during this?
Mm.
And I say that as someone who works for one, like, where have they been? Where are they publicly?
Yeah.
I haven't heard anything from these major brothels about the law.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, I'm not willing to help them with their websites. They're on their own. They're big companies. They're on their own.
Yeah.
Escort agencies are fine. You just have to really watch. I don't know how to exactly explain it, but you can tell the difference between, like, a guy who's setting up an agency website and a guy who's setting up websites for girls he's running.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it sounds like you try to do the best you can, given your limited range of information, to do some
screening. I keep an eye on the sites, too.
Yeah.
Right. I keep an eye on the sites.
Well, I was just going to say, it just sounds like you're checking for red flags to see if there's any obvious red flags.
Yeah, and I've definitely come across a couple of people that I've just outright refused service to because it just doesn't seem right. And I'm always going to go with my gut on that.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a good rule of thumb in this industry for a lot of things, not just web hosting, but
protecting yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that that's actually one of the advantages of having, this is what I like about your model, is having a sex worker run a hosting service for other sex workers means that you also understand the industry. You know what to look for. You know what those red flags are. Whereas somebody who is totally outside of it wouldn't know how to do that. Where can people, if they're interested in web hosting, where can they find that? And where can they also find your other work?
I am at redumbrella.ch. I am building a website now for Tristworthy because I started all these projects and I'm like, huh, I guess this needs like a parent company, doesn't it? And so I kind of did that backwards.
Yeah.
I was like, I guess I need to like collect all of these and put them in some kind of basket. And so that's where Tristworthy Enterprises comes from, is because I needed a basket.
Yeah.
And so I'm working on the site for that so that people can keep track of everything I do. Twitter is the best place to find me, as in God We Trist.
I like it.
I frequently tell people, just flip over the money, because people are like, where'd you come up with it? I'm like, just flip over the money.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good handle. Thanks so much for chatting with us and telling us about your projects.
No problem. I think the only thing I want to cover is that it's anonymous hosting. I don't want your real name. I don't want your credit card number. I don't want your address. I don't want your phone number. I don't want to know where you live. I don't want to know anything about you. I don't want to tie this to your real life.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
It's as secure as I can make it. It's in Iceland. You get a free SSL certificate. You know, I do all of the patches the minute they're out. I take care of everything because I'm a really big privacy nerd.
All right. Well, I think we should wrap up, but it was really great talking to you.
We are here with Mistress Eva, who is a semi-retired professional dominatrix with a past in corporate strategy, the UN, and performance art. She now runs an online BDSM slave training platform and tours worldwide with a base in Bali, Indonesia. So welcome. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, I'm excited to talk to you. We've been Twitter friends for a while.
Yes.
And chat there. So it's fun to actually talk with our voices.
Yeah.
Tell me how you got into being a professional dominatrix.
Oh, so I had just moved back to Australia and I had re-entered a very corporate workforce and I was doing corporate strategy consulting for FMCGs mostly at that point in time.
Okay.
And I was getting paid very well and was living quite a idealistic lifestyle. And it kind of dawned on me that I wasn't satisfied. Mm-hmm. Even though that all of these pieces were seemingly good looking enough, I wasn't satisfied with the content of the work and what I was part of creating. And so I really dropped out in a lot of ways. I get very emotionally involved in what I do.
Yeah.
I just crashed and in many ways, I just shut down. And so I had to leave. In between like having this paycheck and this particular lifestyle and me thinking about how I'm going to maintain all of this, I totally just jumped back into figuring out what my next step was. And all of these things came to me. And one of them was this suggestion that an ex of mine had said to me many years before that. Mm-hmm. And he basically said that you'd make a great dominatrix. And I had a small concept of what a dominatrix was. I didn't understand that I was that bossy to him.
Did your boyfriend suggest that or your previous partner because you had that sort of like DS dynamic with him? Or did he just sense it in you?
I think I've had that dynamic in all my relationships. I think it's inescapable. Yeah.
It's like part of the core of your being.
My partner's in the next room right now, so he can hear everything I'm saying. But I think I'm a lot more artful about it now, and I'm a lot more well-considered. But I think it's an inescapable part of my personality. Mm. And he was just able to articulate it in a way that other people haven't been able to match it up to a job description before.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. It sounds like doing dom work is tapping into your personality.
Yeah, it's the only place that I allow myself to express those sides of me in the great capacity that they are. I think in my day-to-day experience, I feel very uncomfortable being extremely bossy, authoritative, pointing my finger, telling people to do things, structuring everything. And I know I did that in my previous jobs. But again, that was in a very particular confine. It's like because somebody is stepping into this space, and they're saying, hey, I'm okay with this and I'm paying you for it. That kind of really allows it to come out in full force.
Was it easy for you to tap into that? Or did you have to really work on overcoming your resistance to it?
I think I was pretty into it immediately. About 3 minutes.
So you just needed an outlet, basically.
I needed an outlet, yeah. And I still do. And like the same thing with the relationship or just in general. I'm a lot more artful with it these days. I think at the beginning, it was just like, here is all the stuff that I really wanted to say and do. And you are going to get all of it.
Yeah.
Now I'm like, I'm sorry that you got all of it like that. But now I take my time. I know exactly what I'm doing and what reaction I'm going to get and how I'm going to deal with it. Mm-hmm. Back then, I didn't think about things with as much craft. But But yeah, no, it's a very useful thing for me, and I guess for the people who do come to me as well.
That's how you thought about getting into it. Tell me a little bit about when you first started, what that was like and how you did that.
Yeah, so many emotions. This job entails so many emotions and interactions. It was quite overwhelming. I also generally keep quiet to myself. Mm-hmm. But from the get-go, you're in a room with sometimes up to 10, 15 other women, all with very distinct personalities. A lot of the times, either very sure of who they are or not that sure, but they're going to make sure you hear about it, you know, on their way. And so it was very confronting, mostly because of that, rather than even the clients, just being in this space with these women that were just so full of like power. And it was a lot for me, but I learned so much just by sitting around them.
So you say that there's a lot of other women doing your job there. What does a typical day look like?
It was somewhat of a dress code. We had shifts. You sort of clock in, you clock out. You get an email address. A lot of things that seem quite familiar.
Yeah. like any job, slightly, right?
Slightly more sheer in the uniform. It was these two massive houses in what is now a very hip area of Sydney. And they were just, it was labyrinths. Really, it's an accurate way to describe
wow.
it. All these
wow.
hallways and these little rooms with different functions. One's a medical, one's a small dungeon, one's a huge dungeon, like three ceilings heights. And then it's a tiny little pink room full of frills. And then
wow.
there's one with like a wall of, they cater to many things.
Mm-hmm.
Also, yeah, and suspension points and tools. And it was, you had everything that you needed. And it was quite an incredible place to learn because I could play with equipment that I had no idea what it was
before
somebody told me.
Was that overwhelming when you first got in there?
There's parts of life that I'm overwhelmed by that other people are very okay with. Then there's parts of life that I feel absolutely at home in that other people would think is crazy.
I totally relate to that. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is one of those latter experiences.
Yeah.
No, it was fascinating. And if I think back and I unpack everything now, I guess I could have been overwhelmed, but I'm also, I guess, fairly good at managing the packets of information that I'm getting.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's probably what helped me survive and learn.
So what was the relationship like with the other women that worked there? What sort of relationships are forged in those spaces between the women?
I think it really depends on your own personality. I grew up in a very hierarchical Asian society.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, anybody who's been there longer than me, which was everybody, I'm under you and I will respect everything that you say.
Mm.
Even though it's to my detriment, I've put everybody on a pedestal and I could learn something from everybody. That was the way that I approached it. And that probably did me good in that kind of environment because they do like it when you respect like that power dynamic, obviously. So I was, in a sense, I was quite submissive to them.
Mm-hmm.
I deferred a lot to their expertise and I treated them as teachers and elders.
Yeah.
But I did see relationships form a little bit more on the level between the rest of them.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I still hold them in such high regard in my mind that I can barely like get in touch with them now.
That's so interesting.
So, I'm quite scared. I don't want to disappoint them, you know, because they're so skilled and I have so much respect for them. And I still feel like a baby because they will always be older than me.
Yeah, so I heard you say before, going back to how you grew up, that you grew up in a household of women and you credit that to feeling sort of comfortable wielding power over men. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
I mean, my greatest tools are definitely from my mother. As much as she probably doesn't want to talk about it.
Yeah, does your mother know what you do?
We don't talk about it.
Mm,
yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a lot of assumptions that are made on my behalf of me wanting to manage her emotions. And then there's a lot of not wanting to go there from her side as well. So we dance around it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I would like to not dance, but I'm sure you understand that it's an interesting area.
Yeah, we've certainly dealt with that. as so many people that we've talked to have, it seems like a common theme for anyone who does any form of sex work is like how to negotiate things with your family of origin. So tell me what you do think that you got from your family or your mother that made it so you could do your job.
Well, I always saw women making decisions, which is a big thing also. Mm-hmm. They made all the decisions, like life trajectory, where we're going to be, kind of school, kind of whatever, everything. Everything was their final say, always. Uh-huh. That was a huge thing. It was partially the absence of men and partially also just the submission of a lot of the men that were around, deferring to them. A lot of the times also it was a matter of intelligence. In some ways they were a lot more intelligent also than maybe just the men that happened to be in our family.
Yeah.
Also, it's this thing is where you're taught to have a submissive role as an Asian female and to not use your last word. You learn how to control things in another way.
Yeah.
You know, and how to get your way in a much, I guess in a sneaky way, but in a much subtler way that changes their perception in order for you to get what you want.
That's so fascinating because I was having that thought while you were talking a moment ago, where in some ways when we talk about women's socialization, managing emotions, at least in our culture, we often think about that as women submitting to the desires of men in order to please men. But when you talk about it, you talk about it as a way of affecting power over men. Yeah. I was thinking how much you flipped the script on that for me or made me kind of think about it from a completely different way.
And that makes me happy. But it also makes the job harder for people who've been doing that to you.
Yeah, it's funny that you say that because we went to a burlesque show a couple of nights ago and we were talking to some of our friends who are all socialized female people except for PJ.
A common occurrence.
Yeah, yeah. And it was interesting because I was saying that I said something like, I feel responsible for other people's emotions. Like if they're upset, I somehow take that on myself and think like, oh, well, what could I do to make them feel better? Or what did I do to make them not feel so good? And then my friend turned around and said to me, oh, I'm sorry, were you socialized female? And I thought that was really funny because all of the women that were sitting there identified with that in some way.
Yeah. You try to regain power in many ways and forms. And when, especially in this part of the world, you have such little legal say and a lot of, I don't even social say when you use your voice. So you have to use other things.
How does that work? I mean, that was actually one of the things that I really wanted to talk to you about is what is that experience like being an Asian woman who's expected to be more submissive culturally, but has a job in which you flip that?
This is a little bit difficult for me to talk about Sundays because, you know, I listen to your show, for example, and English is my first language, more or less. And I listen to a lot of Western perspective on this. And so I get informed by a lot of Western thought on gender and power. But at the same time, I know that that's just not necessarily my reality because I live in Asia. I've mostly lived in Asia and I am largely Asian and I'm mostly in front of Asian people. And the way that we approach quite different. And so I'm often conflicted about, oh, but I heard this, but actually I understand that it's like this. So I find it a little bit difficult to talk about. But if I think for a moment about what is expected of me and how I think the bigger social issue with what I do is that I work with sexuality. I think that's the bigger social issue rather than a female sense of power. The way that I work also, it's I think in a sense, it's more lifestyle domination and it's it always has a financial element. But this is also very much how a lot of, especially East Asian relationships work. The women take the money when you get the paycheck and they look after everything. And you do what they say and maybe you do whatever you're doing on the side, but that's your thing. And I have a control of the family. So there's not actually so much of like a shift when I say, do you give me this much this month and you will be here at this time and you will do that.
That's really interesting, actually.
Yeah, that's super interesting.
A thing that is different is that I integrate sexuality into that exchange. And I listen, I really listen to their needs. And I address them. I think that's the big difference more than anything else, that I'm really listening and I'm really giving them what they want, but with authority, so that they have seemingly little choice and that they have to do it. They have to give themselves a chance to get their needs fulfilled. I think that's the more radical thing for people around here than the female like dominance thing.
When you listen to Western women talk about these sorts of issues, what seems different to you than your experience?
I'm still very confused. In a lot of ways, it's just a lot more nuanced. I think our challenges here are still, I think they're still a little bit more tied up in survival. And yeah, I think you get the opportunity to have much deeper thought about ideas of gender than we ever really brush up against.
Yeah, that's interesting.
There is still this hunger, like this, well, there's still hunger and you still feel a need to survive.
Yeah.
And then you don't really think of a lot of the nuance in that kind of context.
Mm-hmm.
But I still appreciate hearing those conversations, and it makes me question a lot of things as well.
Yeah.
And realize how fluid things are, because you really have no sense of that fluidity when you're just trying to survive, or you feel like you have to try to survive.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really interesting. So you say that you listen to your clients. What sort of needs do you think that they come to you with that you have to subtly listen to?
I mean, a lot of my Chinese clients, they cry. And at the end of every session, I notice that much more so than a lot of Western clients.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the relief. There's a lot of pressure for deliver. I mean, of course, there's a lot of pressure on everybody, but there's a lot of pressure to provide as an East Asian male.
Yeah.
And I mostly have encountered males during my work.
Yeah.
And I think it's like a release from having to dictate action.
Yeah.
Their action and the reactions of those around them and their expectations. I basically just strip away all of that and I take it on myself.
Mm-hmm.
In that time, it's just a relief.
Yeah.
More than anything else. They're just looking for a relief from life for a while and somebody who can just hold their vulnerability.
Yeah. I imagine they feel a great deal of gratitude for that.
Yeah. Yeah, they do. There's a vulnerability, I think, that's very important. And more than any other need, somebody to recognize that they're small.
You know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And allow them to be that. Yeah. I just think that's interesting because, like, once again, I feel like it flips the script for me. There's a sense in which, like, I hear you talk about that, and it seems as though that kind of control or domination is actually experienced as freedom for people who, you know, otherwise have the pressure of making all these decisions or bearing all this responsibility.
Yeah. I think this job. And any form of sex work, interaction with people on such an intimate level, people are complex. And the longer you play with it, the more you realize that it's a very intricate exchange.
Yeah.
And you're just there to balance out a little bit of life or myself or them.
Yeah.
I really, really love how you can utilize sexuality to find those final outcomes that I talked about in terms of needs.
Mm-hmm.
It mostly catches people off guard because they don't necessarily think that that's going to lead to anything. However, it's such a basic, raw, like, inner self that they're presenting.
Yeah.
It's like this core thing that you can shape rather than having to break through all the data that we're going to have a conversation and da 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 da, and we have to get through all these layers. It's like, here's my sexuality and actually the bundle of like raw needs. And if we can change this, we can change so much.
Right.
You know?
Right.
It's a way to get them to push their barriers.
Yeah.
And that changes into other things in their life very quickly. Yeah.
I don't do that sort of dominatrix work. Actually, I'm really terrible at it. But I think that I don't know because I don't have it in me. I don't know how to do it.
I don't know. Have you done it real time though?
No.
I think that's a difference. I remember the first job that I had, it was on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
And I was at the dungeon already, and it was somebody calling up and probably wasting my time. But it was still something to learn from.
Yeah.
And he was asking whether I did toe spreads. And I'm like, what the hell is toe spreads to my headmistress? She's like, it's when you do this with your toes. And she does it with her hand. I'm like, oh, yes, I do toe spreads. And so it was like, it was intimate, and he had his voice, it was different, and my voice, it was different. But later that day, when somebody stepped into my physical space and they were like, here, just do what you want.
Yeah.
And it's like, you can see it in front of you and you're like, I can do what I want.
Yeah.
You know, it's a little bit different. It's like you can see them and they are literally on the ground naked and you can do what you want.
Yeah.
So it's like, actually, this is, you're asking me to do this and I'm being allowed to do this and my demands are helping you and you really like them.
Right.
And I can see that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm a lot more comfortable doing the demanding thing in that context now. I'm still terrible at it outside of that context.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, I found that with my clients who want some sort of domination, that what I can't do is be like very directly demanding, but what I can do is kind of elicit from them like, oh, you want me to do X, Y, mm-hmm. and Z, and to get them to affirm what it is that they want in that way. But for whatever reason, that must have something to do with my psychology. I have to come at it in this kind of indirect
way. The same. I'm exactly the same. I have to know that it's benefiting them. Otherwise, I just can't do it.
Yeah.
The way you framed it out earlier, mm-hmm. it seems like there is this therapeutic effect that you're trying to achieve, or that is the hope of a lot of the domination work that you're doing. And I thought that was really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's just therapy, but stripping away the talk, starting with the body or starting with sexuality, mm-hmm. and then moving towards change rather than starting with discourse or conversation.
Right. Yeah. 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 And doing it in quite a forceful way also, quite a shocking way. I talk a lot though. There isn't a moment where I don't talk.
No, it sounds like a beautiful thing. I mean, that's one of the things that we've been focusing mm-hmm. on the podcast, but just in talking to so many people, there's so many beautiful things I think that happen in sex work that people outside of the industry,
they don't get the,
don't imagine
they don't get the opportunity either. I mean, it's very powerful, the things that are possible in these spaces to like destroy somebody and to lift somebody up as well, you know. It's a really special job.
Yeah, I think very special people do it.
Yeah, all sorts of reasons and motivations. And I'm not really mm-hmm. sure how other people work, but with the way that you mentioned needing people to name that they want X, Y, and Z, I find it weird to say Z because I want to say Z. Am I saying schedule or am I saying schedule?
You can do it your way.
Yeah. No, but that's to say, it comes down to the same thing, isn't it? It's like, it's so much of my life is about getting the kind of reaction that I want out of you, out of these people, a reaction that's pleasant for everybody. And whether that's self-preservation, yes, it might be. But that's the core of it for me. And I can't demand otherwise. And I don't know, maybe some people can, you know, maybe they don't give, but they don't give a shit. And they just want to demand stuff. And good for them.
Right.
I can't do it like that. That's okay.
Yeah, but I also think that points to the fact that there are a lot of different ways to...
Oh, yes, of course.
To do this sort of work.
How has your practice evolved and what does it look like now?
So at the very beginning, when I had my 3 minutes and then I let loose, my sadism was out in full force and I didn't have a lot of control over it, which worked for some people. And I went through a really big transitory period where I had to learn how much I wanted to bring it into my daily interactions, or where I needed to say, this is not coming into my daily interactions or not.
Mm-hmm.
It was really fuzzy for a good 3 years, I would say. And then I burnt out after maybe 4 years, and I took like a year and a half off, and then I only came back to it maybe 2 years ago. I stopped meditating when I moved to the jungle, but before that I was meditating a lot, like 2 hours a day, and that really helped me reformat a lot of my brain, I guess, and I could approach things with a lot more measure. And since, especially in my meditation practice, I've been able to take all of those really like hard elements of me, the sadism, the way that I love to instigate reaction, and I can put it in neat little packages and I can use it when I want and how much I want to be giving it in each moment now. So I'm a lot more nuanced. In terms of technical skill, yes, things have improved, but I think what is most powerful is definitely the fact that I can control my own psychology now when I enter a space with somebody else, and therefore I can control other people better too.
Yeah. So
that's what's been the major change. I was just somebody with a whip before, go into town, and then now I'm just inching my way into their brain.
Yeah. It sounds actually a lot more emotionally engaged in a sense.
Yeah. I'm also just smarter emotionally, and I guess you bring yourself you bring yourself to your practice. And if you don't have the capacity, you can't bring it to anybody else.
So tell us a little bit about your online slave training program.
So when I came out of retirement, when I came out of the burnout period, I started to see some old clients again, and I started to think about my approach to what I was doing, thinking that maybe I needed something with a little bit more distance. And how could I do that? How could I give that to myself, but still for it to be something interesting, worthwhile? Yeah. And I didn't have a social media presence until maybe almost a year ago now. And so I launched this in January. It kind of fit in with the lifestyle that I was hoping to achieve, something a little bit more hands-off, but still creatively entertaining enough. And it's kind of blossomed in a really nice way. I knew I wanted to have specific courses that kind of inducted people into the way that I operate. And so I did build those, and then I built systems around it so that I could monitor what they were doing, but without too much time also and or energy, so that I wouldn't get drained. Everything's online, and they become members, and they tribute me monthly for access. Different levels get different benefits, so to speak, but they all get access to my photos, videos, and training courses. So it's everything like how I like them to interact with my images rather than just jerking off to it, you know, I want them to think a little bit.
Yeah.
Or maybe send me a screenshot of what you like and why you like it. It's been really useful also because a lot of these online people, they turn into like perfect offline people because they've been inducted, you know?
Yeah.
They know things about me that people who've served me for 5 years don't know. I have a lot of frustration about the world and the way that people live and operate and hurt others. And it's really, really cathartic for me to be able to pull people up on their shit.
I think that's really interesting because, like, Jesse, you don't really consider your work to be like domination necessarily. But on the other hand, a lot of the phone work you do, I think you do try at least subtly push back on.
Not even necessarily subtly. I've said to a lot of clients, particularly in regards to race and gender, because a lot of what you get in phone work in particular is very elaborate fantasies that people want to play out and things that they don't necessarily want to do in real time, but want to explore at least imaginatively. Or sometimes the way that people frame things in regards to gender or race, I'll say, listen, we can do this, but you can't talk about this like this if you want me to engage in it. And what I found, because I also worked in a corporate environment and I also worked in academia and I've had a lot of different jobs. And in most of those spaces, particularly since I've been in very male-dominated spaces, when I voice those sorts of concerns in those environments, they fall on deaf ears. Nobody wants to hear the one woman in the room say that people's behavior is bad.
Yeah.
But in those sort of intimate contexts, when there's sex involved, when they're erotically charged, when they have an interest in me and my attention and my willingness to indulge their fantasies,
that's the time.
They they totally change. Oh, I'm very sorry. I won't say X, Y, and Z. Yeah. I didn't think about this like this.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to me. I've maintained that sex workers can do a lot of good in reframing narratives and ways of talking about things, because I think we have a platform and a space that we don't have in other contexts.
Yeah.
I wonder if in those moments you're tapping into more of like a Dom aesthetic or like a Dom mindset or dynamic or something.
Maybe. I've never really thought about it like that. It's funny that you say that. I just didn't frame it like that in my head, but yeah, perhaps if the end note is I will not talk to you unless you stop saying that. I suppose so.
But then it's also like, yes, this particular experience is cathartic and it's a lot of fun and it's interesting, but why did I get here? Also, it's because I felt like I had no voice.
Yeah.
And so I become really good at finally figuring this out, but only because I had nothing before.
Right.
I had nothing to work with, and all the frustrations made it come to this point.
I guess the fact that in the sexual interaction or the sexual context of the interaction, in some ways,
it's very disarming.
It affords you the ability to put your foot down and take a kind of a stronger position than it might in other contexts.
Right. We got real deep in this interview.
Did we?
It seems like it.
Yeah, I'm happy to chat. It's really nice. This is like real time. Usually it's just in my head on a plane.
So I have one more question to circle back, because I was just thinking. So is there a difference between domination and humiliation? What is the connection between those two things?
I can't really necessarily talk to how other people practice it. How do I practice humiliation and domination? Yeah, I guess it comes back to calling people out more than anything. Mm-hmm. That's kind of how I utilize it. It's like I make them question their own reality, you know, question how they think. And it might be humiliating for a moment, but then I give them a correction also. And so it's like, it's an also an opportunity. So it's like, it's mostly psychological, the way that I like to do it. I think also, to talk to what you just mentioned also, like being just like, when I said disarming and you having a space of somebody that's ready to listen, there's something about the protocol I really, really love as well. And it helps me to put them in a place where I feel that I can talk to them in whatever humiliating way. They're basically never allowed to sit on anything. And as soon as they get in the door, they're on the ground. So, and they're not allowed to look at me in the eye, which I find personally very disconcerting. Like, I find it very confronting in normal life, especially around Westerners who love to look me in the eye. Asians don't do that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So it's like, get on the ground. Like, all you can see are my feet. Now you can hear my voice, and everything that you're going to do, I'm going to pick up on, because I'm no longer put off by you looking me in the eye or you sitting anywhere near me, you know?
Yeah.
And so maybe you think that's humiliating. For me, that's just putting you underneath me so that I can have more control over the situation. And what I think is humiliating is when I notice the bullshit that you have coming out of your mouth or out of your actions, and I'm going to point that out, and I want you to change that. For me, that's how I use humiliation. I guess it's a little bit disarming, and then it's a little bit, hey, no, do this. Now you're making me happy.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you can get into things that are probably more abrasive, like race play or even things like forced feminization, you know, or things that seem more really close to home. And that's probably the more popularized version of what humiliation is in domination, but it's really up to you how you want to use it. But basically, I think it's just this beautiful little moment where people are really put off guard and it's time for change. I think that's basically how I see it.
That's so interesting, because it's like the way you talk about humiliation is so positive and constructive, which is not necessarily what I think people expect.
Yeah.
I want to talk for a second about forced feminization, since you brought it up.
Yes.
So I've had many clients who are very interested in forced feminization who've come to me. At first, it was really difficult for me because to me, as somebody who's a feminist, as somebody who is also very femme presenting, I had a really hard time connecting with it at the beginning because what it sounded like to me is, I think being a woman is embarrassing. The way that they came at me with, it's so embarrassing to wear this stuff, it's so embarrassing to be feminine. And it was hard for me not to find that offensive as a femme person. So I was wondering what you think about that.
The way that the people who've come to me, they've never talked about it being embarrassing. They look very shy, but they never actually said anything. In those situations, and not only that, I've come up with some really confronting things where it's like they clearly have tendencies that they like the sexualization of children. That was probably my hardest one, for sure.
Yeah.
But it's also understanding that this is a safe space and we're going to push in a lot of different ways that I'm also going to feel uncomfortable. I can tell you that I'm not going to go here or go there, and I'm going to correct you if I need to. Also, so don't ever feel that you have to overstep your boundaries. That's the best place to say, hey, fuck you, no, you know, and that's totally fine. Yeah.
Right.
But in terms of forced feminization, I think it's also, it's a chance to correct them. You know, it's like, hey, no, it's wonderful to be like this, you know, maybe they want to be told like, yeah, sure, you look kind of silly right now, but we can make you look really pretty. You know, we can make you look how I want you to look. Like, maybe it feels a little bit embarrassing, but you know what's really embarrassing? Sucking on my pink cock when you're wearing that pink frilly thing. That's embarrassing. Try, you know?
So
I guess it's up to you where you want to take it. And also to understand that the way that you see femme, the way that I see femme, the way that the next person sees femme is going to be different, right?
Sure, right.
I'm going to feel more embarrassed about my vanity one day than I am going to be the next day. And I guess it's, they're like, they're children when they're coming into this space. They have no fucking idea, you know?
Right.
So it's a chance for them to like, oh, well, look how silly I look at this. Actually, no, you look okay, you know? Like, I can make you look worse. And here's your chance to learn how to be more feminine or whatever you decide. What's feminine to you, you know? It could be so many things.
Yeah.
And they're just juvenile.
I think it is a very sort of nascent desire that they're trying to work out. I've spent a lot of time thinking about what my reactions to that are, why it was so off-putting to me at the beginning, but how to try to make sense of where they're coming from, because not everybody is super articulate either. It's hard. This work is really hard.
you come up against a lot of people you wouldn't normally have to converse with. And therefore, that means a lot of limitations of others as well. And I mean, you're so versed. You're so well versed in ideas of gender and presenting and identity. And these people have no clue. I mean, probably. Right. And so,
and that's what they come to us for. Yeah. So,
Well, not that. Sure, they didn't. They probably didn't know that you were an expert.
Right.
They had no idea what they were walking into.
I know, it's actually very funny. One time I remember somebody calling me and he was like testing me to see if I was the right person for provider for him. And he's like, can you explain to me, do you have an idea of what gender roles are? And I was like, I'm a gender scholar. I teach this in college. And he was like, oh shit. Okay, you're right. It's funny because, you know.
Happened? Did you guys have a session?
Yeah, we did. And I'm trying to remember. I think that he became a regular for a little while.
Do you remember what he wanted?
He was interested in feminization. I actually end up getting a lot of people who are interested in cross-dressing and they want to talk about what that would be like to inhabit those roles. But it wasn't just about the clothes, obviously, right? So it was more about, I'm going to use the clothes as a vehicle to inhabiting this other way of being.
It gets so nuanced for so many different people and how they approach it. But if you're going to talk about somebody who doesn't really have vocabulary, I would assume that they're reaching just for something that's not their experience. If they are male, and the easiest thing that they could probably, what's the opposite of male?
Yeah.
You know? So it's probably an escape. you know, and that's right. Their first go-to, maybe. Yeah.
It's interesting. I've also had another experience, which was less about gender roles and more about sexuality. I've had younger men call me who are starting to have like homosexual desires, who've called to just talk about what it's like to be with a man. Yes. I was trying to think of how to say this. What it's like to be penetrated. What it's like to be with a man. That's basically what they want to know. And it's less a desire to have a sexual experience with me, mm-hmm. and more a desire to figure out what it's like to experience sexuality from my perspective, so that they can decide if that's something that, like, a positionality that they can inhabit. And that's awesome. Really interesting.
That's really great.
Yeah, they're coming to you as, like, an expert or a...
It's almost like they're coming to me as a, like, you've had some experiences. Can you tell me what that feels like? And like emotionally, feels like physically, feels mm-hmm. like in a whole variety of different ways.
What do you say?
It's harder to talk about things out of context. The thing that I remember the most, or the most striking call to me, was a 19-year-old who'd never had any sexual experiences, who called me to ask me. He said he was having desires for this particular other boy at his college, man at his college, and he was thinking of trying to pursue that, but he was really afraid. And so he wanted to know, what does it feel like to let somebody enter your body? Yeah. But the biggest thing about that was, he had this idea that if he were to pursue that and start it, that would be, he even used the words, he's like, well, then it would be a point of no return. And so what I spent most of the time doing is saying, actually, that doesn't exist. You can start something, and if you're not comfortable with it, you can stop it, you know, or you could say, hey, let's do this another way. And so, you know, you give somebody advice on practical advice, like, if you're thinking, you know, of being penetrated, then you need to have somebody who's very respectful of you. Yeah. You need to go very slow. Yeah. You need to relax. But but on a more emotional level, if it's not good for you, you can stop it. There's no point of no return. You know, and it was interesting to me, because that was groundbreaking for him. Like, it didn't occur to him that you could have a sexual interaction that you stop.
Yeah,
I think that's really interesting, particularly in, like, a masculine context, the idea of submitting or of receiving and allowing yourself to be penetrated. You know, I wonder if that's also tied up in this idea of giving up total control.
Right. Yeah.
And not being able to, like, differentiate, I can allow you to penetrate me and I can take this role in this sexual interaction, but I still am also consenting, and I can still also say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this, or, you know, I can retain some agency. It's not like all or nothing.
The issue with the all or nothing is that it's also very goal oriented, where you have this idea of what a sexual act is, and it would look like this, instead of saying, you could also just be together. You know,
right.
You can touch each other's bodies. You can see what's pleasurable and what's not pleasurable.
Right.
You can explore. You can do some things and not other things.
Yeah. I'm really enjoying being inside your conversation. Thank you. That boy was very lucky to have heard that from you.
Yeah, I only talked to him once, but I think that's all he really needed was a permission to explore without committing.
Those are lessons.
I mean, that was actually what it came down to.
Almost never learn. So a lot of the time, unfortunately.
It's also interesting to think, I don't know about in your cultural context, but here so many people have such poor sexual education that, or no sexual education, that it's interesting that sex workers then so many times become sex educators.
Yeah.
Like, serve the role that is missing.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't exist.
Yeah.
Children appear.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's terrible. It's really, nobody says anything, even amongst friends, you know. It's almost unheard of that you would mention it.
Wow.
Considering how many sex workers there are also in this part of the world.
Yeah.
Many. Yeah, it's an untouched subject.
Yeah.
Completely. There's no point talking about sexual education. There just isn't any.
That's so interesting.
Right, yeah. I mean, then like the whole burden of all of that falls onto sex workers who, of course, aren't really credited for all of the important social work that they're doing.
Yeah.
Or I don't know. Or people just live with not knowing.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the alternative, of course. Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then they'll have a mistress that maybe that could teach them a thing or two.
It's so super interesting to talk to somebody from a different cultural framework.
Yeah, you got different things.
Yeah, and just different ways of thinking about the same things. And I think that that's what's interesting.
Yeah, and questioning our assumptions a little bit, I think.
Yeah.
You know, it's really good.
Okay. I'll let you digest and then maybe you can tell me about that another time.
Okay.
But I'm interested to hear what you found different.
So where can people find your work?
I only really have my online slave training platform going on these days, which is youwillpleaseme.com. But otherwise, I am still somewhat new to social media, but I am there on Twitter and Instagram. Also, youwillpleaseme.
Yeah. All right. Awesome. Yeah. Thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for yet another episode of the Peep Show podcast. I'm PJ Sage, and you can find me on Twitter at PJ Sage.
And I'm Jesse Sage, and you can find me on Twitter at sapiotextual or at jessesage.com.
We would like to remind you that we have a Patreon account and would appreciate your support. Please visit patreon.com/peepshowpodcast. Our music is courtesy of Joe Kennedy. The show was produced by Jesse and PJ Sage.
Signing off. Have a great week.